بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Welcome to a new session from Film Reading Lectures. And as usual, we start with a neuro case. This is a 66 years old male who came complaining of headache. He did a CT paranasal and revealed some ossification of the maxillary, right maxillary sinus and ethmoidal air cells. But in brain sections or brain cuts, we revealed incidentally discovered lesions involving most of the left cerebral hemispheres. These lesions or these collections is showing extensive involvement of the left cerebral hemispheres and abutting the frontal, parietal, occipital lobe, and even the temporal lobe. This is a typical example for the subdural hematoma. In this case, it is isodense to the brain parenchyma, so it is subacute stage, and this stage is easily to be missed during examination as it is similar to the brain parenchyma. And if we do not concentrate about such lesions, we can easily miss such lesions. The typical finding of subdural hematoma or collections is the concave inner borders, is the long or extensive involvement of the most of the cerebral hemisphere, unlike the epidural hematoma. Also, there is some finding, interesting finding here that can be a clue for such lesions, is the absence or effacement of the cerebral sulci in the same side of the subdural hematoma. We can see there is there are multiple sulci here, but here there is absence of these sulci with effacement of this sulci, and this could be a clue for abnormality present at the same site. So if you should notice the sulci, or you should look at the cerebral sulci carefully, and if they are effaced or if they are absent, usually there is indicate that there is a problem in the same site or in the same region. So here there is an effacement of the sulci. There is no sulci here, but there is here sulci is preserved. So there is this is due to the mass effect from the subdural hematoma. Also, we can see there is a mild compression of the ipsilateral ventricle and mild or minimal midline contralateral midline A midline shift. So this is a typical example for the subacute subdural hematoma associated with mild mass effect, and you should look for the effacement of the sulci. This is an important sign, and you should look at the take care that such lesion is easily to be missed, as these lesions are isodense to the a normal brain parenchyma. Okay, this is a very interesting case. This is a 27 years old male who came complaining of left side eye proptosis, mild left side eye proptosis. He came for doing an MRI orbit for such complaint. Okay, this is the MRI brain. We do an MRI brain, and one section or one series for the brain, and the whole study for the MRI orbit. Okay, this is the axial MRI flare for the brain. Okay, we can see that there is a predominantly or likely extra axial lesions with convex inner border, indicate that it is epidural in location. is indenting the right frontal lobe. Such lesion is exhibiting high signal in flare images with low signal intensity, central low signal intensity within. Such lesions is usually related to opacification of the paranasal sinuses. So we must examine the paranasal region to see this abnormality, to identify the nature of this abnormality. Okay, we can see this in the coronal images. We can do a corona T2 like this, okay, and corona T1. The paranasal regions is best appreciated in coronal images, as we know. Okay, we can see there is a near total opacification. Near total opacification, most of the sinuses are near totally opacified. Okay, frontal sinuses, ethmoidal air cells, and posteriorly the sphenoid sinuses, both maxillary sinuses, most of the sinuses are near totally opacified. And also there is a low signal intensities within these sinuses, and there is a mild expansion of the most of the involved sinuses, most evident at the posterior ethmoidal air cells. Okay, such involvement or such affection of the paranasal region is usually due to allergic fungal sinusitis. The typical finding of allergic fungal sinusitis are multiple sinus affection, and in this case there is a multiple sinus involvement, near total opacification of the involved sinuses. Usually the involved or the affected sinuses is usually near totally opacified, as in frontal, ethmoidal, these sinuses are almost opacified or completely opacified. And again, this is one of the characteristic features of allergic fungal sinusitis. Also, there is a low signal T2 intensity within the central of the involved sinuses. Again, this is with the fungal hyphae present within the allergic fungal sinusitis. Usually it is of low T2 signal and mildly or slightly high T1 signal. It is usually a characteristic for fungal infection, and again this is one of the characteristic features of allergic fungal sinusitis. And the last feature here is the presence of expansion of the examined paranasal sinuses. The allergic fungal sinusitis is usually associated with expansion of the affected sinuses due to complete obliteration or complete opacification of the involved sinuses, and usually leads to expansion of the involved sinuses. Actually, there is two atypical finding in this case. And usually we do not see it or them in allergic fungal sinusitis. The first atypical finding is such expansion in the posterior ethmoidal air cells. We usually see a mild expansion in the sinuses, but such expansion is marked, and even it looks like a mucosal formations. It the sinuses is markedly expanded, and it's similar to mucosal formation. And one theory of the mucosal formation is allergic fungal sinusitis. They say that the allergic fungal sinusitis is one of the causes for mucosal formation, but it is not common. But in this case, the posterior ethmoidal air cells is markedly expanded, mounting to a mucosal formation. And this mucosal here, or this expansion of the posterior ethmoidal air cells, may explain the proptosis that present in this patient. It is compressing, as we see here, compressing the media rectus, and usually causing mild eye proptosis. If we draw a line here extending along with the zygomatic bones, we can see that the posterior part of the eye globe here, the posterior part of the eye globe here is much smaller as compared to the right side, and this is indicate that there is a mild left side eye proptosis. All these eye symptoms is usually due to the posterior ethmoid myxoid formation, and this is very common in posterior ethmoidal myxoid, is usually compressing or indenting the orbit, and usually associated with orbital symptoms. The other unlikely finding or atypical finding in allergic fungal sinusitis is such extension. We almost sure that this lesion is usually or is related to the paranasal sinus affection or paranasal sinus disease, as it is closely related to the involved sinuses, and it exhibits the same signal characteristic of the sinus infection, the high T2 with central T2, low T2 signal within such extension. It is similar to the involvement of the paranasal region. Okay, but it is not common that allergic fungal sinusitis extend intracranially. The allergic fungal sinusitis is non-invasive fungal infection of the paranasal region, so it is not common to the affection of the paranasal region to extend intracranial or interorbitary or outside the paranasal sinus boundaries. In such case, in this case, the extension is usually comes from the expanded or markedly expanded posterior ethmoidal air cells. Here, as we know, we noticed here, there is a marked expansion of the posterior ethmoidal air cells. There is some sort of defect here of the roof of the posterior ethmoidal air cells, and extension of the content from the posterior ethmoidal along the plenum sphenoidal and to the floor of the anterior cranial fossa, forming the extra axial collection here. So this extension is usually from the markedly expanded posterior ethmoidal air cells, this is not common, and this is very atypical in allergic fungal sinusitis to extend intracranially, but the sinus here is markedly expanded, and such expansion causes rarefaction of the bony boundaries, and the secretions or the content is extend along the anterior cranial fossa, and usually such extension usually involve only the extra axillary spaces with no definite infiltration or no definite involvement of the brain parenchyma. Such extension, we should make sure that such lesions is not infected and not biogenic in nature, so we should look it at diffusion weighted images. As here, this is the ADC value. We can see that the lesions is high in ADC value. This indicate that the lesion is and diffusion is low in diffusion and high in ADC value. This indicate that there is no diffusion restriction, and this is not with abscess. And in post contrast enhancement, we can see the collection here is not taking enhancement, just peripheral enhancement, but with no definite enhancement. That indicate this is a collection and not a solid masses or solid component. And here we can see the defect in the roof of the posterior ethmoidal air cells and the extension along the plenum sphenoidal and the anterior cranial fossa, and so this case is a case of allergic fungal sinusitis associated with posterior ethmoidal mucosal formations causing eye proptosis and eye and orbital encroachment, and associated with intracranial extension causing epithural extraaxial collection. Okay. This is a 42 years old female who came complaining of a history of breast cancer, and she is complaining now of dyspnea. This is the CT chest of this patient. We can see here a subtle abnormality, but it is an important abnormality. Is the thickening of the interlobular septi. Thickening of the interlobular septi is usually noticed as a appearance of the secondary pulmonary lobule, such polygonal structure at the periphery of the lung. You can see that there is a appearance of the secondary pulmonary lobule. Once you see the secondary pulmonary lobule, this is an abnormal, and this is indicate that there is a thickening of the interlobular septi. This means that this thickening is usually mean that there is thickening of the pulmonary interstitium. As we know, the pulmonary interstitium is peripheral pulmonary interstitium, meaning thickening of the interlobular septi, and central pulmonary interstitium, thickening of the bronchovascular bundle. But here there is evident thickening of the interlobular or peripheral interstitium, evident by thickening of the interlobular septi. There is another signs that can make the diagnosis of thickening of the interlobular septi or peripheral interstitium more easy is to look for the fissure. If you suspect or if you have a doubt that there is a thickening of the interlobular septi, you should look for the fissures. As we see in this case, the fissure here is thickened. There is a thickening of oblique fissures here, and this thickening again may ensure that this is there is a thickening of the peripheral interstitium. The peripheral interstitium is can be seen in the as a thickening of the fissure or thickening of the interlobular septi. Thickening of the fissure is much easier to be appreciated than thickening of the interlobular septi, although in this case the thickening of the interlobular septi is almost obvious. Here we can see the thickening of the interlobular septi. So this patient have a thickening of the peripheral pulmonary interstitium. Thickening of the pulmonary interstitium in a patient with a history of breast cancer, you should put the diagnosis or should the possibility of the lymphangitis carcinomatosa. So this patient usually have a lymphangitis carcinomatosa evident by thickening of the peripheral pulmonary interstitium. And if we noticed or if you see carefully that such a thickening here is actually it is a beaded thickening. It is not a smooth, it is a beaded thickening. So this is again with lymphangitis carcinomatosa. Lymphangitis carcinomatosa usually can do a thickening, either smooth or beaded thickening of the pulmonary interstitium. But in this case, this is a thickening and beading of the fissure, and this is with the lymphangitis carcinomatosa. In such patient, we should look for other metastases. So we can do a bone window, and we can see here there is an extensive sclerotic and lytic marrow lesions involving whole the spine, examine the spine, the sternum, the thoracic cage, and again this is with the scapulae, and this is with extensive bone marrow metastasis. So this is a patient with a breast cancer who had a lymphangitis carcinomatosa and extensive skeletal or bone marrow metastatic deposits. Okay, this is a 34 years old male who have a history of ICU admission since 2 months, and he now complaining of dyspnea. He did a CT chest. And this is the axial sections of the of the chest, lung window. We can see here there is areas of irregular decorations associated with areas of architecture distortion here. This is a distortion of the lung parenchyma. You can see there is a distortion of the lung parenchyma, okay, associated with areas of bronchiectatic changes and areas of honeycombing. You can see there is a definite bronchiectatic changes and areas of honeycombing. So there is a definite element of fibrosis. All these features are with fibrosis. Fibrosis usually present with an irregular reticulation associated with areas of architecture distortion, honeycombing, and bronchiectatic changes. So this is an element of, there is an element or there is areas of fibrosis involving the anterior portions of the middle loop and lingula, and also the anterior portion of both upper loop. Okay. Such fibrosis with areas of honeycombings in such distribution is usually such distribution is atypical for usual interstitial pneumonia or lung interstitial lung disease. So we shouldn't do we shouldn't put the possibility of UIP even in the presence of honeycombing, as the UIP involvement is usually involve the usually the lower loops and usually involving the pleural recesses. Here they are clear, so this is not a UIP. Okay, such distribution is usually typical for the post ARDS changes or fibrosis, post ARDS fibrosis. In patient with ARDS, they usually have an extensive pneumonia and extensive lung consolidation, usually involving the dependent portion of the lung, as the patient usually lying supine and usually admitted to the ICU, and usually have a consolidation usually in the dependent regions. The patient is lying, usually lying supine, and the non-dependent areas here are usually less affected and usually have no areas of consolidation or pneumonia. So in the patient usually needs ventilation and oxygen support, high pressure oxygen support, and the areas of the lung that are usually affected or usually injured by the high pressure oxygen is usually the aerated area or the non-consolidated area, which are the anterior aspects of the middle loop and lingula. So the distribution of fibrosis involving the anterior aspect of the middle loop and lingula and the anterior aspect of the upper loop is usually in such patient is usually due to post ERDS changes, is due to injury of these aerated non-affected areas by the oxygen, high pressure oxygen, and such injury healed by fibrosis and causing fibrotic changes, irregular bronchiectatic changes, as in these patients. So this is atypical for the post ARDS fibrotic changes. And the rest of the lung here, it is not clear. It show a nodular ground glass density present within the dependent portion, and usually these are the sequelae from the previous pneumonias and lung inflammation. These are the residual from such inflammatory changes, and so the case here is typical for the post ARDS changes, especially in the presence of history of ICU admission, for correlation with clinical data and previous unavailable studies. This is a 15 years old male who came complaining of he came complaining of jaundice for MRCP. This is the MRCP. The images here is distorted due to absence of significant periradical dilatation. In the axial images, we can see here, this is the axial spare images or T2 fat sat images of the abdomen. We can see there is a extensive bright T2 signal surrounding the portal tract. These are representing a periportal edema. This is extensive periportal edema. Also, there is a marked gallbladder wall thickening. This is the lumen of the gallbladder, and this is the mucosa collapsed, and all these are the submucosal edema. There is a marked submucosal edema and wall thickening. And in acronal images, we can see there is an enlargement of the liver, and we can see this is the wall edema or wall thickening of the gallbladder and the periportal edema signal. All these features are typical for acute hepatitis. This is the typical for our radiological signs or radiological feature of acute hepatitis: enlargement of the liver, marked gallbladder edema, marked extensive periportal fibrosis, and the patient clinically has jaundice. And these features are all with acute hepatitis. This case is an example for virtual gastroscopy for one of the bariatric surgery interventions called vertical banded gastroscopy or vertical banded gastroplasty. The technique of the virtual gastroscopy, the patient usually swallow an effervescent, and this effervescent help to distend the stomach with air, and we do a CT images and do 3D reconstruction to do the these images. So this is the technique of the virtual gastroscopy. It is similar, looks like similar to the virtual colonoscopy. Okay, in such bariatric surgery, which is called vertical band gastroplasty, the surgeon separates the upper part of the stomach using metallic stablets and this separation is usually occur along the upper part of the fundus and upper part of the gastric body, and disconnect the stomach into or separate the stomach into two components, the residual pouch and the remaining stomach. This small residual pouch is still connected or remain connected to the main stomach through a small stomal opening. The idea of such procedures is that the food is pass into the residual pouch. This residual pouch is small and easily to be distended. Once the residual pouch is distended, the patient feel a gastroscopy can be done for assessment of this residual pouch and to assess the volume of the residual pouch. We can measure the volume of the residual pouch, and to exclude the other complication of the gastric vertical band gastroplasty. And one of the most important complication is the disruption of the stablets separate the residual pouch from the remaining stomach, and communication between the residual pouch and the remaining stomach. This such communication is a failure for the procedures and called gastrogastric fistula. The gastrogastric fistula is a communication between the residual pouch and the remaining stomach. and such complications is represent a failure for the procedures, as the food usually pass within the defect or within this communication to the remaining stomach, and the residual pouch is not adequately distended, so the patient will not feel a satiety. Okay, and this we can see here, we can see here that this is a normal finding for vertical banded gastroblastia. We can see there is no communication between the residual pouch and the remaining stomach, unless except at the site of the stomal opening. This is a normal, and we can measure the volume of the residual pouch here. We can see the volume, or measure the volume of the residual pouch. So this is the value of the vertical band, the CT virtual gastroscopy in patient with vertical banded gastroblastia, and this is one of the examples for bariatric surgery. Okay, this is 67 years old male who had a history of Crohn's disease. This case is represent a typical finding for chronic Crohn's disease with a fat halo sign involving the terminal ileum. This is the terminal ileum here. This is the terminal ileum, and we can see there is a mild mural thickening involving the distal ileal loops or terminal ileum, and showing the characteristic submucosal fat attenuation. This is submucosal fat attenuation. This is the submucosal fat attenuation or fat halo sign is a typical for chronic Crohn's disease or chronic ulcerative disease. So this is the typical submucosal fat attenuation or submucosal or the fat halo sign in patients with a chronic ulcerative or chronic Crohn's disease. There is no other complications. There is no fistula. There is no stricture. There is no abscess formation. Just this is a finding of a chronic disease in a ulcerative patient or in a in Crohn's patient, the submucosal or fat halo sign. Okay. This is the last patient here, 9 years old patient who had a history of hypertension. There is a well-defined ovoid-shaped lesion in the right suprarenal gland. This lesion showing areas of cystic area of degeneration, showing a fluid level with dependent fluid exhibiting dark T2 signal, impressive of hemorrhagic transformation or hemorrhage. Okay, such lesion is usually representing adrenal pheochromocytoma. Adrenal pheochromocytoma is the symptom or the signs of the radiological signs of the adrenal pheochromocytoma is the well definition of the lesion with no signs of invasion of the surrounding. The area of cystic area of degeneration that are bright in T2 signal that can leads to the light bulb sign, and the areas of hemorrhage that occur due to the hypervascularity of the lesions. All these features are keeping with adrenal pheochromocytoma, and after contrast injection we can see that the lesion is hypervascular or intense enhancement. So this again with is a hypervascularity of the lesions. So all these signs are keeping with adrenal pheochromocytoma. So this is a typical finding, and even in a clinical presence of the clinical history of hypertension, and in such a young patient is again with the adrenal pheochromocytoma. So the radiological finding in adrenal pheochromocytoma with definition of the lesions, areas of cystic area of degeneration within the lesions, areas of hemorrhage within the lesions, and areas of our AVID enhancement, after contrast enhancement, indicating hypervascular or hypervascularity of the regions. All these features are keeping with adrenal pheochromocytoma. Okay, thank you very much.